Back Issues. I am Sal.
I'm Tiffany.
And I'm Ben.
And I noticed that Ethan's not here. That's because Ethan quit.
Yeah, he's gone.
He left the show. I'm sorry. No more Ethan. No getting physical with Ethan.
Nope.
That dream died.
We do wish him well.
Yeah. He's on a new project. You should probably see him on his own personal channel, which is incidentally called Getting Physical with Ethan. No, we're just kidding. He's just sick.
Yeah, he's got a cold, so he can't make it.
And don't go to that channel. I don't know if it's a real channel, but like it's not his.
I don't think it is yet.
No, it will be now. Anyway, today I thought we'd talk a little bit about Superman. This book is called Superman: Last Son of Krypton. This book was written, I believe, in 2008. It's by Jeff Johns, who everybody loves. He's got a great interview-sounding name, Jeff Johns. Make sausages. What up?
Hey, Jeff Johns.
Jeff Johns. You imagine a good firm handshake is attached to that name. So yeah, but Jeff Johns, who's kind of like the DC architect for the New 52. He wrote the Justice League book that we read for the New 52, and he's written every Green Lantern story that matters in the last 20 years, and like he wrote Blackest Night and stuff. Like he's a big deal, and
he's kind of
a big deal.
But he doesn't take himself too seriously, which is nice.
I mean, like,
how do you know?
I don't actually know. I've never met the man.
Well, that's just it. I'm assuming with a name like Jeff Johns, he's like, not pretty cool.
Yeah. He's a pretty chill dude.
I make books.
He was either comic writer or senator.
Yeah, exactly. Republican Senator Jeff Johns here.
I've got two first names for my name.
Exactly. This book is still pre-New 52.
Okay.
So it's great.
Like 5-6 years?
Yeah.
Okay.
No, less. New 52 was 2011, so...
Oh, really?
3 years, yeah. Oh, yeah.
I thought New 52 was like 2012 or 13.
That's... Well, you know why you think that? Because they're still calling it the New 52. Even though there's nothing new about it.
And I really only started reading a lot of newer comics in the past
this,
year.
This, like, year, yeah.
Because of the show.
Exactly.
That makes sense.
They're kind of cementing it in the Superman movie mythology a little bit.
Okay.
So it's post-crisis, pre-New 52, DC continuity. So it's all the same shit you remember and like. But because nobody cares what the Fortress of Solitude looks like, and because Richard Donner, the director of Superman and part of Superman 2, is involved with the story, they decided to pay homage to a lot of the things that he helped generate.
Huh.
So there's a lot of, like, Jor-El in this book. There's a lot of the crystals in this book.
Does Jor-El look like Marlon Brando?
Fuck no. He looks like an old dude, but thinner and with a beard.
Oh, okay.
The story kicks off without wasting any time. Superman's at the Fortress of Solitude. He's talking to his dad, Computer, and Computer Dad says, you're not... Like, it just basically reinforcing the idea. You're not human. You're Kryptonian. You're the last of your kind. There's no more coming. And you can't have babies with humans. It's kind of reminding him, like... You know,
this, you're it.
You're a alien. Like, your physiology's not gonna work with a person. I don't care if you look the same. And then this pod crashes in Metropolis.
Oh.
And everyone's like, oh shit, alien invasion! And there's a little boy, like around like eight years old, in it. And the pod looks Kryptonian. And Superman gets there and he's like, whoa! And the Office of Metahuman Affairs / Star Lab scientist people go to pick him up. Just in the DC universe, there's like a... Because of aliens like Martian Manhunter and Superman and Green Lantern's like whole, you know, space cop alien interaction thing, they're like, we need to get a lid on this alien thing. So they created like a office of, you know, the government that like deals with metahumans.
Kind of like BPRD.
Yeah. Only out in the open.
Right.
Like they have an office over there. Like you could go there.
Okay.
But they're also very hush-hush about like what they do and how they deal with things and stuff like that. So at first Superman's like, this is a good idea, because these guys have, like, computers and biology scanners, and they can figure out, like, where he's from and what he's all about. But when Superman goes to the lab to talk to him, the kid is speaking Kryptonian.
Oh. He's got a race car bed!
Really?
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
Well,
he also has a block that has all S's on it.
Yeah.
Like, you know how blocks usually have different letters?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's just all S's.
That's the S block.
It's the S block.
Wait.
But check out the race car bed. It is pretty cool. It's sleek.
Well, he's a little boy. They want to make him feel comfortable.
I know.
Wow.
Actually, you can see there's, like, the whole setup of the room. Like, It's like, it's cute, and then you realize that there are scientists. Like,
yes!
In the observation pen.
He also has a giant square box TV.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, we can't afford flat screen.
Well, it's 2008, so maybe...
They're flat screens.
Yeah, well, they're also cheap, probably.
This is goddamn science lab! He gets a race car bed!
That's true.
They probably blew all the money on the race car bed.
Yeah.
Those things are very expensive. So, Superman goes to see him, and he's speaking in Kryptonian, and they're, like, they're conversing, and then the kid, like, picks up this huge... The reason why he picks it up, or why there's a CRT TV, is so that the kid can pick it up with ease.
Oh, okay.
Well, and so he does to demonstrate his power, and Superman's like, shit, I think this kid is Kryptonian. And the kid is really, like, immediately, like, imprints on Superman. Like, immediately, like, is like, don't leave. Like, don't leave me here. And Superman's like, I have to be Superman, so, like, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll stay here until you fall asleep, and I'll be here before you wake up. And he's like, okay. So then he falls asleep.
It's a hard thing to promise.
I know, but he does. So Superman goes to visit his wife, Lois Lane, and...
Whoa, they're married?
Yeah, in the pre-New 52 post-Crisis continuity, Superman and Lois Lane got married a long time ago.
How did they consummate the marriage? They can't.
They can bang. He just takes it slow.
And gentle.
Yeah. They're not going to kill her with his Kryptonian cock in this comic. So anyway, he goes to his wife, Lois Lane, and she's like, so what's up with the boy? And he's like, I think he's Kryptonian.
Do they ever have sex while he's flying?
I mean, they have to, right?
How could you not?
I don't know. I feel like that would be a novelty. You'd be like, all right, well, that was fun.
Well,
but it would be, like, cold. That's right. He radiates heat.
I was going to say, it doesn't have to be, like, super up in the air.
Oh, I thought you meant, like, whizzing through the city. Like, they're just banging as they go. Yeah. Like,
that would be awkward.
I was thinking
more, like, 3 feet off the bed.
Oh, yeah, let it all time.
No problem. I thought you were, like, you know, he's taking her to work, and he's just like, you want to do a quickie real quick?
Yeah,
and
he bangs her on the
way. Well, he couldn't do a quickie, because then he would...
He would kill her.
Yeah, that would be a way to lose control.
Well, in Dark Knight Strikes Again... Superman and Wonder Woman do have, like, thunderous sky sex across the planet.
Because both of them can fly.
Yeah. And she's, like, strong.
Well, that's gross.
Yeah, it was dumb. And Lois is, like, kind of iffy about it. She's, you know, she's, like, the crack reporter. She's, like, really, like, you know, you're a very trusting soul, Clark, but, like...
Let's know the facts first.
Let's know about what's going on here. Like, I know you desperately want there to be, like, another Kryptonian... But, you know...
This whole burden of being the last son of Krypton is really getting to you.
Well, also, like...
Let him be the last son of Krypton.
If he is Kryptonian, I know you're going to want to raise him. And I don't know if I want to be a mom. Mm. Which is interesting. It's an interesting dynamic.
But she's a career woman.
That's right.
It's more of like a, I'm going to take you around and teach you to be another Superman kind of...
But he can't be doing that all the time, which means that when he's out being Superman, who's going to watch the kid?
Well, I imagine the kid would have to be with him.
Not all the time.
Needs to be.
No.
I think that he would probably want his surrogate or adoptive son to be, like, to have a normal life first.
Yeah, he like, he'd Superman be like, no, you've got to learn old. About, like, you have to learn about humanity. And who better to teach you than Lois Lane? And she's like...
What?
And he's like, goodbye!
Yeah.
No, who better to teach you than this public school?
Right.
No one will bully you.
No, but they'll also...
He'll just drop the kid off at Ma Kent's.
Yeah.
There you go!
Hey, I live in Kansas.
You did this shit.
You did really well last time, right?
Well, that's actually an interesting point, because, like, alright, so Superman and Lois are talking about that. Lois is writing the article about the kid who fell from the sky. So the next morning, Superman's like, okay, I'm gonna go visit the kid. And he has, like, a teddy bear with him.
Aww.
To give it to him. So he's flying across the city. And when he uses his X-ray vision before he gets to the compound, he notices it's gone. The kid's gone, the compound is empty. And he's like,
oh, the compound is still there.
Yeah, the compound's still there, but, like, the kid's gone, and, like, all the
equipment. And the race car bed?
The race car bed is also gone.
Fuck!
So he's like...
They drove that right out of there.
So Superman's like, oh, no.
So no,
he shows up at the other compound where the kid is located, and he breaks the fuck in there.
There's a second compound?
There's another compound. There's, like, a higher security. It's more like a military compound, as opposed to a research and development compound.
Okay.
So, because the military is like, you know, this is a metahuman boy with superpowers like Superman, like, this is a national security issue. Like, we want to keep him under lock and key. You can't just be taking this kid, you know, into your... We know you're going to want to take the kid. And, like, he could be a bomb, he could be a monster, he could be anything. We don't know. So, we just figured we'd take him.
He could, you know, be a bomb monster.
So Superman shows up at the compound, and he beats the... He just destroys this place. Like, breaks through this huge, thick wall, and, like, bends all their guns, and they're just like, hey! Superman, what are you doing? He's like, who told you you could take the kid? And they're like, we did. He's like, he landed on Earth. He's like, our kid. Like, and he's like, no. So he takes the kid and leaves.
Whoa! That is a weird turn for Superman.
I love that turn. It's that Superman being like, we protect our own. Like, oh no, we're not, no.
That's a really strange character choice for Superman. Because just like, look, I get that I'm all about humanity and shit, but yep. I finally found someone who's like me. This has never happened before.
No, I don't take it like that. I take it like he's like, if I hadn't landed where I landed, this would have been me.
Oh, yeah. I'm sure that's a thing. He doesn't say that, but like, we know that's true. In Flashpoint, he does land in Metropolis and kills a bunch of people, and the military keeps him under lock and key for his entire life.
Oh.
So he takes the boy to his parents in Kansas, and he's like, you forged documents and you raised him to become a man. Tell me how you did it.
Wait, Superman's dad's alive?
Yeah, in this continuity, he isn't dead yet. He actually takes him to the Fortress of Solitude as well, and he brings him before the AI, and he's like, who is this? Like, whose kid is this? Like, who had a rocket that was going on around the same time? And he's like, there is no record of this kid. Like, he is not from Krypton. But he is Kryptonian.
Huh.
Oh.
So, sorry to make your search a little more difficult, but good luck with that.
Thanks, computer dad.
Can't you just scan him or something?
So, Lois goes to Kansas, and, like, Clark and Lois and John and Martha and the kid are, like, talking and trying to figure it out, and, like, Lois is freaking out. Not in, like, a offensive, like, extreme way, but in a kind of, like, everybody's really excited and happy about this, but let's all be kind of more realistic about it. Let's be a little more pragmatic. And the kid, of course, throughout the whole thing is in stout and Kryptonian. Like, he doesn't speak English.
You know whose other perspective mirrors that would of Lois's?
Who's that?
That would be Batman's.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He'd be like, another one?
Ooh, I don't know if I have enough kryptonite.
Damn it!
So while they're arguing with each other, the kid starts to speak English.
Just
out of the blue. Like, he starts speaking English.
Like, and clear English.
Yeah. And it's basically that he picked it up, like, from...
like, he learned it really fast.
Like, he learned it really fast. And, like, in that...
Like, he's growing really quickly.
Yeah, but he's not. Like, it's not that. It's not, like, Jack.
I have another guess.
Okay, what's that?
I don't want to say, because if I'm right, then I don't get to be surprised.
Okay. All right, we'll get there. The kid learns English, and apparently he learned it, like, while he was, like, at the lab. Like, talking to those scientists and shit like that. Like, hearing them talk. And...
Oh, man, it's like he had a language party in EverQuest.
Yeah.
They just spammed it at him, and eventually he picked it up.
There you go.
Woo-hoo!
I didn't play. And then he takes the kid to Metropolis, and they have, like, a press conference, where he's like, so the military tried to take this kid from me, but they're not going to, because I'm effing Superman. And I want you all to be witness to the fact there's a little boy here who's scared and alone and needs guidance, and the military wanted to keep him for themselves, and that's not going to happen now, because the people now know, and because he's under my protection. So, that's the end of that.
I would absolutely love it if the people were like, no, give him to the military.
Yeah, no. And I'm sure
that Superman's like, hey!
Well, push. So,
no, then we're getting into Man of Steel territory.
Yeah. Yeah. So, right during that conference is going on, Bizarro shows up.
No!
Bizarro Superman. And he tries to take the kid. Because Lex Luthor read the article about the miracle boy who landed in Metropolis. So he sends Bizarro to pick up the boy.
Why does Bizarro work with Lex Luthor?
Because that's how they do it sometimes. It's just, it's the stupid thing. Like, in the Superman animated series, Lex Luthor clones Superman, but he didn't do it right, so it's this kind of like Down syndrome Superman that they call Bizarro, and it's really weird. But in other universe, in the comics, like, Bizarro's from, like, the Bizarro dimension, where there's other, like, where there's inverted versions of all the superheroes. Like, there's Bat-Zarro and
right.
stuff.
If Bizarro were to be scanned by the computer, would he come up as Kryptonian?
No, he would not.
Okay.
The computer would be like, that is not, I don't even know what that is.
Cool. I just want to make sure it wasn't, like, some weird Bizarro kid.
Yeah, no. It's not Bizarro's kid.
That was not my guess.
Okay. That would have been cool, though. It's not. So, Superman, like, kicks the shit out of Bizarro.
And which always seems kind of sad to me.
It's really sad. Well, he's always reluctant to do it. He's like, Bizarro, you know better, like, than this. But Bizarro in this is not, like, a man-child, like he is in the cartoon.
Okay.
So it's not quite as depressing to watch Superman beat Bizarro.
Well, this is setting a really bad precedent for the kid.
Yeah. So then we have this cute scene where, like, Clark Kent and Lois Lane are walking through the Metropolis version of Central Park with the kid. And they're like...
Hold on.
Yeah.
Does the world know that he's Clark Kent?
No.
Do they know that Lois Lane is married to Superman?
She's married to Clark Kent.
Okay.
But they know who this kid is.
Yes. Well, they gave him glasses.
Really? Yes. God damn it!
Are you...
And because everyone on Earth is retarded, that works perfectly. So, you know... But they...
The only person more famous than Superman right now
is that
is this
boy.
Kid. And they're like, that can't possibly be that kid. He's wearing glasses. By the way, who is this?
Yeah.
When did this person get here? I don't recognize her at all.
Yeah. I think they...
That's right.
Yeah. I think they argue... Well... They figure out his name. You know, where they're like, we need to give him a name. Like a regular person name. If he's gonna live here, we gotta teach him shit.
Does he have an alien name?
Yes, he does. But we don't know it until later.
Okay.
He has a Kryptonian name.
Okay.
So, but it's a cute scene between, like, Clark and Lois and the kid, and they're talking, and they're like, you know, like, do you have any ideas? And Lois is like, you know, like, before I became a reporter, when I was just a girl who liked to name my kids in my mind, like, the one I had in my mind was Christopher. Which is really sweet, because it's named after Christopher Reeve.
That is really sweet.
And, like, they start talking about, like, what they're going to do with him, and, like, how they're going to teach it. And they start, like, mentioning, like, oh, God, when Batman finds out. And he's like, who's Batman? And, like, you're not meeting Batman until you're at least 25. Like, and I know why. Because, like, this kid is 8.
He's Robin age.
He's Robin age. Like, ooh, an indestructible Robin! Come on, Chris, I got all the ice cream and race car beds you can ask for, and all I need in return is your knights. Put on this Target costume and come with me. We gotta go to the Joker's house.
What was that? You got no legs or arms? Oh, well.
No, good luck with that. Joke's on you. And then, like, they mention, like, Wonder Woman finds out, like, holy shit. And he's like, who's Wonder Woman? And they're like, someone you're not going to meet until way later than that. Like, because the last thing that a prepubescent boy needs to do is meet Wonder Woman. Yeah.
Can I live with her?
Yeah. No, you cannot. Also, they will, like, her people will slaughter you.
Because, so, like, there's a whole island of them?
Yeah. Oh, no.
Goodbye! Fly. Shit. I knew I should have put him on a leash.
Yeah. This least means us both. So, then another pod lands.
What?
In the Arctic, near the Fortress of Solitude. One identical to the little boy pod, but it's an adult pod. And out pop 3 Kryptonians. General Zod, Ursa, and Non.
I didn't want to say it was Zod's kid. Is it Zod's kid?
It is Zod's kid.
That was not my guess.
Ah!
See, the learning really fast threw me off. I was like, is this some sort of Brainiac child?
Ah, yeah, to, like, lure Superman in, and yeah, that would be awesome.
See, since he has all the knowledge, and I assume, like, certain genetic qualities of Krypton, so he's not...
He just made him, this is what a Kryptonian kid would be like if I used all this material.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
That's what I thought you were telling me.
That's a really cool idea.
So quickly, yeah. Is because he's part, like, bionic. Yeah.
That's really cool.
That would be a fantastic
That said,
game.
I still like the...
No, I like that too. I just was like that.
Yeah, well, that would be really cool.
When we were talking about his name, I was like, does he have an alien name?
Yeah.
He's like, yeah, but we don't want to find out. So I was like, well, it can't be an L. What's Zod's last name?
Yeah, it's Zod.
He's Zod. It's like Mary Maria.
Yeah.
He's Zid-Zod.
I can't remember what the hell his name is, but it's like something hyphen Zod.
Oh, okay.
But the kid doesn't like that name, doesn't respond to it. Because he's like... Like, okay, so Zod and Ursa, they're not, like, in love or anything like that. It's not like the Kryptonian scientists from All-Star Superman. Like, these two are just warrior douchebags. And they're like, we should have a kid. Because then, like, the Kryptonian race will continue, and he'll do what we want. And he'll be super powerful when we escape from the Phantom Zone.
Right, what about the other guy?
None, who gives a shit? He didn't even talk. So, they
look stern.
So what they did was they used... Actually, what they... There's apparently a... Like, a prison compound in the Phantom Zone. And it has escape pods in it. And I don't know why! But they use them!
And they get out of the Phantom Zone!
And they get out of the Phantom Zone!
That seems like... Wait, so the kid was raised in the Phantom Zone?
No, they raised him in the Phantom Zone.
So how does he not remember the Phantom Zone?
I don't remember why he doesn't remember the Phantom Zone. I think it's more like he chooses not to remember, or he chooses not to tell them about the Phantom Zone. Because it's like... Zod's not a great dad.
Well, it's probably traumatic.
Yeah.
It's like escaping an abusive, like,
that's family. Exactly right, and they are. Once the Zod family, like, land in the Arctic, they're like, you know, once we get a hand that boy, like, he will be punished for escaping. I guess, like, he escaped. I think, like, it's more like he used an escape pod.
Oh, okay. That would be cool.
So,
and then there's, like, here, escape pods?
Yeah. The fuck? So
you mean to tell me a great guy like General Zod isn't
Father of the Year?
Yeah.
Believe it or not.
Is Ultron 8
a better father than Zod? Zod?
Easily. So, they go to the Fortress of Solitude.
Okay.
Now,
has he met them before? In this
continent? Oh, yeah. Superman sent them to the Phantom Zone.
Okay.
Again. Like, he knows them.
Okay.
And when they get to the Fortress of Solitude, it's funny because, like, they see the Jor-El computer, and he's like, ah, Jor-El! What? No! And Jor-El assumes, because it's a computer, that, like, any Kryptonians that are in the room are Superman. So it's like, you know, hello, son, what can I do for you? And he's like, tell me about General Zod, and about all the great things he did in Kryptonian history. And he's like, oh, Zod is a complete maniac, and an insane person, and he's a murderer, and blah, blah, blah. And this incenses Zod to no end. He's like, oh, the Kryptonian history books are all wrong! I'm a brilliant leader and a great man, and what the fuck's wrong with you, Jor-El? And he gets mad, and he goes to Metropolis, and he's like, I'm gonna take my kid, but first, I'm going to use the machinery in the Fortress of Solitude to open the Phantom Zone and release all the prisoners.
Because that'll show everybody what a great man I am.
Well, he's also an asshole.
What a terrific leader.
Yeah.
Well, it shows everyone in the Phantom Zone.
Right. So he, what winds up happening is he actually winds up stranding Superman in the Phantom Zone. And releasing.
Oh.
Yeah. And releasing all these other villains from the Phantom Zone. In fact, I don't even think it's that he opens the door. It's more that, like, there are other pods, and all these pods land, all these, like, these...
Who put these pods
in? I don't know!
A really bad designer.
It's really stupid.
You know what we should keep in this inescapable place? A pod that can escape it.
Yeah.
Good call.
Good call. It's a good plan. It's a good solid plan. You're fired. Yeah, in fact, I think, like, the pods... Yeah, here's the scene. The pods rain down on Metropolis like warheads.
Why is it only Earth that gets these pods?
Well, because they're, like, aimed at Earth. I don't know.
Are these all Kryptonians, or are they...
Yeah, they're all... Well, because the Phantom Zone was a Kryptonian prison. It's just where Kryptonians put bad people.
Well, I also know that the Kryptonians were involved with other species.
Oh, like,
they
yeah.
know of them, so...
It's true.
I wasn't
no, sure there are no, like... There's no, like, Martians or anything like that in there. Right. No, it's just Kryptonians. So, it's just beings that can get superpowers from the sun.
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah. Okay. And so they strand Superman in the Phantom Zone, and Superman's like, I'm fucked.
There should be some escape pods.
They're all gone.
They're all gone.
Yeah.
There were just enough.
They're not all gone.
Exactly.
I think there's one left. Because Superman needs to escape the Phantom.
Exactly.
These are cool redesigns of them.
Oh, yeah. I love the redesigns of Zod and Ursa and Non.
Yeah, I like that a lot.
Yeah, they have these cool robes.
Well, yeah, the prison outfits.
Yeah.
Like, they're all the same.
Non is nuts.
Right? Look at that.
Non is this hulking beast.
Yeah.
He's like the Juggernaut.
Yeah, he's way cooler than the movie version.
I'm also really digging their symbols, because they're more angular.
Yeah. Yeah, more like evil design.
You know, straight lines are evil. Yeah. Curves are a good thing.
That's right. Well, Superman's all about curves.
So I married Lois.
That's right.
What is happening?
I don't know what's happening. We need to stop. So, Superman gets trapped in the Phantom Zone, but really? Thankfully, there's another person in the Phantom Zone that isn't an asshole. There's a guy who is not Kryptonian, but seems Kryptonian. His name's Mon-El. And Mon-El was a character that was created in the 60s.
Okay.
And he's not Kryptonian. He's another race of beings that are like Kryptonians.
But his last name is El.
Yes. Because he thought he was Kryptonian. So he just took Superman's like last name. It's a weird story.
Why didn't he escape?
Why didn't he escape the Phantom Zone?
Yeah.
I'll tell you why. Because he's dying. Mon-El met Superman when he was a boy. But not like a little boy, like a super boy.
How?
Well, Mon-El winds up like landing on Earth.
okay.
in a rocket, okay. not unlike the way Superman did,
okay.
and not unlike the way Christopher Kent did, and not unlike the way Supergirl did, and all these Kryptonians who escaped from the fucking Phantom Zone. So, you know, rockets landing on Earth are kind of like
just a fucking rain in the town of Superbots!
Right. So no, Mon-El is actually a Daxamite. And Daxamites look and act look like Kryptonians and have superpowers like Kryptonians.
But speak English.
Well, they learn English when they get here. So, Mon-El meets Superboy, and he's like, Kryptonite doesn't affect him.
Oh.
Which is why he thought, like, which is what tipped Superboy off to Mon-El not being a Kryptonian.
Mm-hmm.
So what Superboy did was he wanted to play a trick on him. So he's like, so he exposed him to lead, and he's like, ah, and it really, like, affected him the way Kryptonite would, which revealed that he was actually Daxamite, and it actually wound up giving him poisoning.
So,
like, Superboy...
He
got lead poisoning, and he's like, so he started to die. So Superboy poisoned this kid in, like, a practical joke.
He could have used aluminum foil and said it was Kryptonite, and it wouldn't have affected the guy at all.
No. But Daxamites are actually...
I don't know if that's even a joke or a prank.
Superboy poisons Mon-El, and then to save his life, he put him in the Phantom Zone.
How does that save anyone?
When you're in the Phantom Zone, you're in, like, a Schrodinger's cat situation where you're neither alive nor dead. Like, you're just in this state of, like, suspended animation. You don't age. You don't die. Except for the boy. Because here's the thing.
Except for the boy and except for Mon-El, who was dying.
Yes. Well, he doesn't... Like, it prevents... It preserves him.
Right.
But that building in the Phantom Zone, when you go inside of it, you're not really in the Phantom Zone anymore. So, you're not affected by...
Is that building, like, a guard shack?
It's like a big fortress thing.
I was thinking, like, maybe the designers of the Phantom Zone...
Oh, yeah, no, it's like...
We need to have people who go in there and monitor.
Yes, that's what it's
supposed to be. And what if they get stuck in there? Well, they're going to need a way out.
That's right. That's exactly what it is.
But I don't know why you've got, like, a fleet of escape pods.
Well, it's a big facility.
There are a lot of guards in there. Or there were.
Yeah, until Zod and his minions killed them all.
And ate them.
Yeah.
And use their bones to make their bread.
Yeah.
Because they're all ogres. But here, like, look at, like, this is, like, the design for the Phantom Zone. Like, when we're in the Phantom Zone, we have, like, these, like, this is what it looks like.
Oh, that's cool.
I'm digging this art.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's Adam Kubert, by the way.
Hmm? Was it Green Lantern in there?
No, it was just when the Kryptonians start attacking, all the superheroes show up to, like, fight them.
Oh, okay.
That's so cool. Like, hey, they actually address that.
Yeah.
So he's fighting Mon-El.
No. Superman gets to the Phantom Zone, and Mon-El's there, and he's like, hey, like, you're fucked. Let's get out of here. I'll try to figure out how to get you out of here. So he takes him to the...
Oh, Mon-El's not mad.
No, Mon-El is like... Mon-El and Superboy were like, fuck, I didn't mean to totally screw
you
over.
Oh, I thought Mon-El was like...
Was like, you ruined me. No. Mon-El gets poisoned, he's like, okay, well, the only way I can fix you is by sending you to the Phantom Zone, and one day I'll find a cure, and I'll save you.
But he kind of forgot about it.
Yeah, well, he totally forgot about that.
There's no cure for it.
Sorry. I got married, though.
Yeah.
Yay.
Where's my present?
Yeah.
You kind of owe me a wedding present. Sorry.
So then they get to, like, the Phantom Zone, and or they get into the prison facility, and they find an escape pod. They put Superman in the escape pod, and they send him back. And
was it the last escape pod?
Of course it is.
And Mon-El stays there?
Yeah, because, like, when he's in the prison facility, he's no longer in the Phantom Zone, so he starts to die again. So he's like, I got to go back to the Phantom Zone.
Oh, that's sad.
Yeah, it's really sad. Like, I feel really bad for Mon-El.
Yeah.
You should. So, the Kryptonians naturally defeat the Earth.
Yeah.
And
it's not that hard.
It's been, like, maybe a month or a couple of weeks, because time's weird in the Phantom Zone.
Right.
So, Superman gets there, and, like, the world's fucked. And he's like, God damn it. And, of course, there, like, the Justice League was defeated, and everyone's trapped. Like, you see Batman's captured, so, like, you know nobody's going to get out of there.
I can't help but notice that, is that Non? Or
yeah.
Is it someone else?
Yeah, Non grabbed Power Girl and Supergirl. I'll take the ones with the tits.
They're mine.
So, dibs. Yeah, but...
Dibs.
But Christopher Kent is like, no. Like, Superman would have fought against you, and so I will too. So aww. He, like, doesn't accept them, and he, like, fights against them, and they, like, beat the shit out of him and stuff. It's really sad. So, and Superman shows up, and He doesn't immediately take the fight to Zod. Instead, he finds Lex Luthor, one of the only people who hasn't been captured by the Kryptonians. Because Lex Luthor has spent a lifetime avoiding Kryptonians and figuring out how to defeat them. So, Superman shows up and he's like, Lex! And Lex is like, oh, it's you, the guy who sealed our fate and ruined the world. Good job.
Hey, buddy.
Hey, man.
Hey, thanks.
And, I think, and, like, so Lex has, like, a team of other Superman villains, like the Parasite, and, like...
Oh, shit.
...other characters, and they're called, like, the Superman Revenge Squad or something. Supervillains aren't nearly as good as coming up with team names as superheroes. But, yeah, the Superman Revenge Squad is, like, so here's the deal. Let's go fight the Kryptonians.
Right.
So Lex, like, shows Superman his arsenal of Superman-killing weaponry.
Ugh.
Like, his kryptonite gun. It's just a gun that shoots, like, concentrated energy blasts of kryptonite. And, like, all these other things. And Superman's like, oh my god, dick! Yeah. And he's like, what's to stop you from murdering me right now? And he's like, if I kill you right now, you'll be a martyr. And I'm gonna defeat you. Because I'm Lex Luthor, and I'm a jackass, and I'm my
own...
How
would he be a martyr?
Because Superman is clearly against these other Kryptonians.
Okay, okay.
So Superman and the Superman Revenge Squad go and attack the Kryptonians.
That's
and
really cool.
It's amazing because it's one of the like only times you get to see Lex Luthor kill Superman 1,000 times. Because Lex Luthor's like, oh my god, this is great! He's shooting Kryptonians and then just like... And... Oh, Superman...
Laughing.
Yeah. And like, they have access to like different types of kryptonite, and different kinds of kryptonite can like fuck up Kryptonians in different ways. Like, green kryptonite is, like, poison.
Right.
But, like, red kryptonite will, like, fuck up your physiology. And, like, black kryptonite will, like, turn you inside out. Like, there's different types of kryptonite for different types of things. And, like, so Lex, like, hands out the kryptonite to his Superman Revenge Squad.
Is that Bizarro?
No, I don't even think Bizarro's in that. I think they've
captured him. They let him guard the base.
Yeah, you guard the base, Bizarro. Or
no.
Don't guard the base. Yeah. So, Superman and Lex Luthor... So Superman and his greatest enemies go and kill all the Kryptonians. And Lex is like, don't worry. Like, the fight is more or less a diversion. Not unlike Aragorn's assault on the Black Gate.
Okay.
The real plan is... Which I'm not going to tell you. Is...
he's not going to tell the other team?
He's not
going to
tell
Superman.
It's okay. Really more like, okay, so Lex's actual plan is... What I'm going to do... is I am going to use technology that I have invented that has to do with the Phantom Zone. I'm going to open a gate to the Phantom Zone and turn on, like, this tractor beam. Basically, it's an interdimensional portal that will act like a black hole, but it will only affect...
Kryptonians.
No, those who have been in the Phantom Zone.
Like Superman and the boy!
Yes, and
oh,
all
shit.
His Kryptonians. So the fight is a diversion, everyone's fighting, and, like, the Parasite's, like, sucking all these Kryptonians, like, oh my god, I'm so powerful, this is what it'd be like if I killed Superman, this is awesome, ah! And, like, one of them, like, turns the Kryptonians into regular people, so, like, they're falling out of the sky and splatting on the ground, and, like, it is a...
That's horrific.
It is a nightmare
vision.
It's
so cool.
And then, like, Lex turns the fucking switch on. Go for it. So Lex turns the switch, and it opens the portal, and all the Kryptonians are like, yeah! Including Superman, who's like, ah, damn it, Lex! And the linchpin of the situation is, everything is sucked up. That's right. No. Everything is sucked through the Phantom Zone. All the Kryptonians and all their dead bodies and shit are being sucked into the Phantom Zone. And it won't close until every last one is there.
Oh.
But it doesn't affect it affects Superman in that it pulls him through. But for whatever reason, it won't close until Christopher goes through. So, Superman and Christopher are, like, fighting against the... the... What?
Nothing, go.
Superman and Christopher are fighting against the pull... And, you know, and Christopher's like, you have to let me go. Like, I have to go through the portal or it won't close. And you'll be lost again. And Superman's like, we will find another way. Chris is like, there is no other way. But I know that you'll find a way to save me. And then he, like, throws Superman out of the way and goes into the Phantom Zone.
Aww.
And then the Phantom Zone closes up. And Christopher is in the Phantom Zone. Superman has, like, a window, like, communication device to communicate to people in the Phantom Zone, like Mon-El.
Yeah, that's why I was like...
Yeah, so he, like, uses that to call Mon-El, and Mon-El can't find Christopher.
No!
But he promises he won't stop looking for him. Mon-El never finds Christopher.
Why? What happened to Christopher?
He's in the Phantom Zone somewhere. Probably hiding from his dad.
Do they ever address this again?
I don't think so.
Really?
Well, then they rebooted everything a couple years later. So, like, no.
Wow.
Yeah. So in the end, like, Zod has this kid who is bred to be a weapon against Superman, and Superman, in essence, adopts him and imparts his own lessons of altruism and righteousness, and it rubs off on him. And Christopher winds up saving, like, the world and Superman.
Oh, I had a question from earlier. It's really random.
Okay.
It has nothing to do with anything.
I was no, let's hear it.
Okay. When you mentioned that, in this, computer dad has, like, a beard and stuff.
Yeah.
So, does Clark have to shave?
Yes.
We've dealt with, like, how...
Yeah, he focuses his energy beams from his eyes into a mirror, and it bounces off, and he burns the hair off.
Does that mean you could collect those and then make some sort of, like, needle gun out of his beard
shavings? You could argue that, yes, his hair is actually super strong.
If he cut it off, not if he burned it off. And maybe the laser just burns.
I think he actually incinerates
it. Oh, okay. But just imagining all these little hair shavings, and you're like...
Yeah. This is in me, like a porcupine.
Yeah.
In Superman 4, The Quest for Peace... There's a scene where, like, Superman donated a strand of his hair to the Smithsonian, and they use it, like, they tied it to, like, a huge weight.
Oh, that's cool.
Which is actually, like, the cleverest thing in that movie, because it's something that we would actually do.
Yeah.
Where it's like, one strand of Superman's hair can hold, like, 1 ton.
Oh, I wonder how much 90s Superman's hair could have held then.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Because if you're not familiar...
With all that product?
Superman, in the 90s, after he died and came back to life, had a mullet. Like, everyone during that period. Even Spider-Man had a mullet. Like, but it just... looked. It was... This is in the front! Like, Superman in the front! And then this huge mullet in the back. And the way that Superman managed to make people not realize that Clark Kent and Superman were the same person... You know, the glasses weren't going to be enough. He put his hair in a ponytail as Clark Kent.
Brilliant. Brilliant. Wow. Man is a master of disguise. A master of disguise. Yeah.
I love this book. You have a little funny story about this book.
I do! This is the one.
For the Free Comic Book Day, a couple of years ago, to usher in the New 52, DC published a, like, New 52 Superman book with, like, Jim Lee's design Superman on the cover. And we were like, oh, we should pick it up. Like, because it was their way of, like, introducing you to the New 52.
Yeah, I think I remember that.
Yeah.
Yep.
And it was the first issue of Superman Last Son.
Yep.
Of Krypton, which was pre-New 52. Because there was nothing good or strong enough from the New 52 at the time that had Superman in it.
I remember us talking about
actually bring
it
in.
Yeah, and I was really excited. I was
you were like,
wow.
This is really cool!
And like, you were like... This sucks.
Yeah, I'm
they
like,
just gave us a book that we've already had.
Yeah, right, but at first...
Well, I didn't even know. Like, so you were talking about how great it was, and I'm like, really? So I read it, I'm like, this isn't even the New 52!
No, actually, we realized it wasn't.
That's right.
Because I asked Danielle what she thought about the new costume, and she's like, well, it looks like the old costume. And I was like, what do you mean?
Yeah.
And, like, I hadn't really thought about it while I was reading it, because I was just enjoying the story.
Right.
And then I looked at the front with the new costume,
yeah,
like the little neck thing, and I looked at... all the pages in here, and I was like, what is happening?
Wait a minute. Yeah.
I'm like, maybe this is, like, before? Like, they're leading... Maybe he hasn't changed the costume?
Right.
Nope, they just slapped their new 52
logo
bullshit on the front of it.
And then reissued it.
I don't even know, because I really haven't read any of the new 52 Superman, so I feel bad calling it bullshit. I only call it bullshit because of the fact that it was misleading.
Well, it made you think that, like, this is New 52.
Yeah.
And this story's good, right?
Right.
So buy New 52.
Exactly. If you like that, you'll love this. If you like this stuff that came out a couple of years ago, you'll love the stuff we're doing now.
Yeah.
Because it's totally different. Now, that said, there are some cool New 52 Superman stories.
Oh, I have no doubt. I didn't care for the misleading nature.
No, it was bullshit.
Yeah.
And there was some cool New 52 Batman stuff.
Yeah.
And, of course, everyone knows Aquaman rocks.
That's right. And he doesn't talk to fish.
No.
No, not at all.
Got it.
So... Superman Last Stand of Krypton by Jeff Johns, and with some help by Richard Donner.
Gotta do finger guns when you're saying Jeff Johns.
And art by Adam Kubert, who I never get to see do enough. I always see Andy Kubert doing some great stuff, and he's fantastic. But Adam Kubert is exactly as awesome as his brother. Definitely pick it up.
Yeah.
It is a great Superman story. And you don't, need to know what happened before or what's going to happen afterwards. It's just a great self-contained story. You know, everybody always says, it's hard to write Superman stories. Who could do this? This is a fantastic Superman story. It is simple.
Yeah.
But brilliant and clever and cool. This concept with a lazier writer would be forgettable. But with this, it's just fantastic. It's one of my favorite things written by good old Jeff Johns.
It's also cool that if you get the trade...
Yeah, you get this other story.
You get a second story.
And it's equally cool.
Okay.
I don't like it nearly as much as Last Son of Krypton, which is why I didn't talk about it. But it's really cool. The stuff that they did in Superman Brainiac, they're retconning, what Brainiac was like. Because sometimes Brainiac's a robot, sometimes he's a bio-organic being, and sometimes he's green, and blah, blah, blah. This one was just no, Brainiac's a dude. He's just a big, scary alien guy.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah, there he is.
Which is what he kind of was when he was first invented. It was only, actually, I think in the cartoon, when they started to, establish that Brainiac was more of a robot. And, what do you guys think? Any thoughts?
Yeah, I would totally read this. I read the first issue, and I like that a
That's
lot.
That's right.
So, yeah. If it's as good as that, then...
Yeah. Now, here's a question. Would you want to see... if, let's say Chris Kent didn't go into the Phantom Zone, would you like to read a Superman story or a book where Superman has to raise a kid? Or is that,
I think if it was a one-shot...
Oh, like a self-contained story?
Yeah, if they were here's issues 1 through 5,
right.
I don't know, whatever. Mm-hmm. Whatever it would take to tell that, that would be kind of fun. Like a
mini-series.
Yeah, almost an Elseworlds kind of thing.
Yeah.
What if he didn't go in there? How would it have worked out? I think that's kind of neat.
I think you would need a lot to tell that story. I think you would need at least, two trades worth to tell a good story of Superman raising a kid. To the point where, the kid could be on his own at that point.
It could be, each issue was, a certain period in the kid's life.
Yeah. Oh, that'd be cool.
You see how the history is changing around them. If Clark and Lois make it.
Yeah.
Relationship-wise, you don't even have to tell the story that happens. You just understand.
Right.
You know what I mean? Does the kid end up also being raised a bit by the Justice League? Inevitably?
Yeah.
I don't know. That's cool.
You're going to stop spending weekends with Uncle Bruce.
Yeah, he's...
bad influence.
He would be a terrible influence.
Lucky Bruce! Hey, boy, how's
it
going?
Hey, how you doing? You want to take a trip over to the Middle East with me?
Boy, do I!
Let's go. Suit up. Suit up. Suit up. You know what? There's a special, Robin suit.
Yeah.
It just has a bullseye on it.
I would like to see a design. What would Christopher Kent Robin, what would his costume look like? As opposed to, Decoy from Tiny Toon Adventures. But thanks a lot for watching, everybody. You can click the like button, subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. It really helps out the show. And click this annotation here to see every episode of Back Issues that we've ever done. And we will see Ethan soon. He'll be back before you even know it. So, thanks a lot for watching, everybody. I am Sal.
I'm Tiffany.
And I'm Ben.
So long, and have a great 2015.
Woo!